In 1988, Dr. James Hansen, then director of NASA's Goddard Institute for Space Studies, stood before the U.S. Senate and testified that
global warming has reached a level such that we can ascribe with a high degree of confidence a cause and effect relationship between the greenhouse effect and observed warming. It is already happening now. This last year, 2021, comes in as the sixth warmest year on record, and it continues this large, long-term warming that Jim Hansen was detecting even in 1988. And in 1988, that was also a globally warmest year, but now that ranks only 28th in the ranking. And so the warming that we've had since Jim Hansen's testimony has been dramatic and totally vindicates the concern and the warnings that he put out at that time.
The Goddard Institute for Space Studies, or GIS for short, maintains NASA's record of Earth's surface temperature, called GISTEMP, that shows a clear and unequivocal increase in our planet's temperature. GISTEMP stretches from 1880, long before NASA existed, until the present day. Now, when you think of NASA, you probably think of, well, space, right? And we do lots of work studying Earth from above. But the GISTEMP record is actually built from the ground up. We collect measurements taken from weather stations, Antarctic research stations, and ships and ocean buoys all around the planet to understand what temperature changes look like globally. And why does the record start in 1880? That's the earliest period that we have sufficiently reliable measurements from ships and weather stations in enough places to be confident in the global record. Interestingly, it's also shortly after the time we call the Industrial Revolution, when humans started putting significant amounts of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. But we'll get back to that later.
There are millions of measurements over the last 140 odd years. We put those together. We're using data from literally tens of thousands of different stations around the world. We use the information that's there to create a global picture of what's happening. And that gives us a very accurate estimate of how any year ranks, or what the anomaly is for any one year compared to what happened in the 19th century or what happened in the middle of the 20th century.
So we have our statistical reconstruction of Earth's recent climate, but in research science, we like to check our work. There are a couple ways we can do this. First of all, teamwork. Our colleagues at NOAA and at other agencies and universities around the world also create their own records, and we can line them up side by side and see just how closely they align. Everyone's independent climate records show the same thing. Earth is warming significantly and rapidly. And here at NASA, we have an even cooler way to check our work. Space. Right now, we have more than 24 satellites dedicated just to studying our planet. Satellites can take measurements of the entire planet and line them up with our estimate of global temperature change. And sure enough, they also match. Our measurements from space match up well with what our analysis tells us. Earth's climate is warming. The next big question, why is our planet warming? Well, let's jump back to the Industrial Revolution. The release of carbon, mostly carbon dioxide, from human activities like driving cars, flying planes, and industrial burning of fossil fuels is responsible for the majority of climate change. Carbon exists in stores underground as oil, gas, and coal. When we burn it, we release it into our atmosphere, where it traps excess heat coming from the sun, raising the temperature. We've known for more than a century that carbon dioxide added to our atmosphere traps additional heat and is a major contributor to the greenhouse effect. So we can also track the concentration of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere, the primary cause of the current climate change. Both from space, using NASA satellites like the orbiting carbon observatories 2 and 3, and from the ground. If you've heard of the Keeling curve, you're familiar with one of these records. Researchers have been taking daily measurements of atmospheric carbon dioxide from Mauna Loa, Hawaii, since the 1950s. From space and the ground, the signal is clear. There's a lot more carbon in the atmosphere than there used to be. Other things have changed too. We've chopped down tropical forests, caused the ozone hole, and filled the air with soot, smog, and other kinds of air pollution. And this is on top of natural variations caused by the dynamics of the ocean, or volcanoes, or variations in the sun's activity. And so we can ask whether it's human activities warming our planet. At NASA, we have some big and powerful computers, able to make 6.8 trillion calculations per second. We put these huge supercomputers to work to recreate Earth's climate. So we have thousands of ideas of what could naturally cause climate change. We have 4 billion years of history, where nearly anything and everything you could imagine has impacted Earth's climate. But each of these events has their own distinct fingerprint, which we can identify, a pattern of behavior with natural variability. Using supercomputers, we can run simulations of natural climate drivers, solar energy changes, wobbles in Earth's orbits, ocean turnover, volcanic eruptions, and we can run simulations of human effects. And what we've seen is...
it's us. There's no way around it. Looking at the evidence, we're the force that's enacting these changes. I am so proud of our ability to understand the climate, but I'm terrified of what we've found.
But it's not just the causes of climate change, it's also the effects. Because it's not just about knowing why our planet is warming. It's also about understanding and preparing for the effects of added warmth.
Measurement of global average temperatures is so important because it's one of the most direct indicators of Earth's changing climate. But the Earth is really a system of environmental systems, land, ocean, atmosphere, and ice, and changes in one system impact the others. Our oceans are our first line of defense in climate change because they absorb so much of the extra trapped energy in the Earth system.
We are seeing the impacts of climate change now. Now we know that as our climate warms, wet areas are getting wetter and dry areas are getting drier. For example, we see more intense snowstorms. We see slower hurricanes that are causing more precipitation that inundate land. And we have more extreme precipitation in the form of atmospheric rivers that come from the Pacific and reach our west coast.
The oceans are absorbing a large amount of heat because of climate change. And once that heat is in the ocean, it actually travels all around the planet because of the ocean currents. And that has impacts on local weather and long-term climate.
As the planet warms, it's not just the ocean that's warming, it's also the ice that sits in the ocean and on land. The ice on land being warmed increases melting, which is increasing freshwater input into the polar oceans and causing sea levels to rise across the globe.
So as the climate is changing, we really are seeing a lot of changes to the environment up in the Arctic. We're seeing more permafrost thaw when it's warmer up there. The warmer air temperature can lead to warmer ground temperature, and we get that thawing of that permafrost layer.
We're finding that the fire season is being exacerbated by longer periods of drought and decreased snowfall.
Knowing that our climate is changing due to human activities means that we know how to lessen the effects of future warming. And knowing how we know what causes climate change confirms that our efforts would be meaningful. The situation is serious, but it's not hopeless. Together, we can decide to make a better choice.